How do you bring back a 20-plus-ton cylindrical capsule from the very edge of space and get it to touchdown at zero? Perhaps you're thinking the answer lies in complicated equations revolving around rocket science and aerospace engineering. But what if I told you we can break it all down to some simple classical mechanics that will allow us to craft a clear intuition? From liftoff to state separation and ultimately landing, we're encountering physics in motion. Forces, momentum, energy, impulse, all the stuff from your physics textbook, determine burn profiles, guidance choices, and landing windows. So, whether you're a SpaceX enthusiast, an aerospace and engineering nerd, or a high school student pondering how the equations you grapple with every day are relevant in real life, this video is for you. We'll start at the very beginning with the launch. As the engines fire up, clamps release, and the rocket lifts off the ground, at the very instant, the thrust exceeds the downward force due to gravity. Now, as we're building straight up from the basics, let's take a look at the free body diagram of an idealized rocket system. Let's take the z-axis as the upward direction and picture the forces acting on the rocket at any instant. So we have thrust denoted by T acting upwards and an opposing force, mg, due to gravity, that acts downwards. Now you can note that as the engines light up, the thrust grows past mg, the net force points upwards, leading the rocket to accelerate, take off, and climb upwards. This is Newton's second law in action. Mathematically, this allows us to find the acceleration of the rocket at the liftoff stage by balancing the forces. And we don't need calculus for this as the initial velocity is zero, and we also consider the mass m to be roughly constant, although we'll see later while looking at propulsion mechanism that that's not the case actually. So the engines are up, the guidance system holds the line, and throttle begins high and then settles. We are basically watching two things rise and then cross each other through time. The velocity of the rocket increases as the air grows thinner, which is expected, and then dynamic pressure grows because it loves speed more than it hates thin air. And then there is a moment when the combination of increasing speed and decreasing density of the atmosphere creates maximum aerodynamic stress on the vehicle. And that point, called max Q, is represented by the crest you see in this graph. The stress the rocket experiences at this juncture is crucial for rocket design, since insufficient structural stress can lead to disintegration of the rocket. As you can see, Q depends on air density and velocity squared. So as velocity builds, it tries to drive Q up, and then again with altitude, density falls and tries to pull Q back down again. The peak in this graph appears when those two trends balance, and that is why throttle dips right around that instant in order to keep the loads inside a safe envelope. Now, we can link this concept back to force, specifically drag, which tracks dynamic pressure directly. That is, drag force, Fd, is proportional to Q. So you can scale it up by shape and area, and that gives you the external shove against the ascent. Bigger Q means greater drag, and hence larger bending and skin loads, and more work for guidance system and control. You can visualize the rocket as a long beam, and the exhaust shoves downward to create the upward thrust, while weight pulls downward as mg, and the air adds its own downward push, set by Q. Let's track the rocket further along its path. What we are looking at here is the rocket's trajectory under the influence of the gravity turn, which is a fuel-efficient maneuver where the rocket pitches off after launch, allowing gravity to slowly curve its trajectory into orbit. Initially during takeoff, the path of the rocket is almost straight upwards, and then it bows into a long arc towards the horizon. So, if you decompose the rocket's velocity vector into its components along x and z, at the initial instance you'll see that vz is large while vx is very small, which is expected since the rocket is initially launched vertically, allowing it to get through the thickest part of the atmosphere as quickly as possible while continuing to accelerate into space. But along the flight, as speed keeps building up, the spacecraft gimbals its engines to rotate the vehicle to align itself with its launch azimuth. And at this point, Earth's gravity, which is acting downwards, steadily takes over and tries to pull the rocket back to the surface, in effect aiding the velocity vector to turn towards the horizontal. The flight path angle gamma thus decreases over time. Now, some way through the ascent, about 2.5 minutes after liftoff, at an altitude roughly between 65 and 80 kilometers, the first and second stages of the rocket separate while the path is still fairly upright. This allows the first stage to begin its boostback burn for landing, while allowing the second stage to ignite its engine to reach orbit while becoming lighter and significantly more efficient by shedding unneeded mass. At the instant of separation, both stages still share almost the same velocity, and the only external force at the time is that due to gravity. Thus, the total momentum stays the same. This also implies that the motion of the center of mass of the rocket does not change. To understand the concept of center of mass, think of the two-stage vehicle as a combined body with a balance point, which is the weighted average of where the mass can be thought concentrated. External forces determine how that point moves, while internal pushes only shuffle momentum inside the system. So, without an external shove, the center of mass of the combined system travels along the same path the rocket would have taken, had there been no separation. The release of the second stage from the booster causes equal and opposite impulses on the two stages, which once again shows that the net change in momentum of the system as a whole is zero. But these impulses do cause a rotation as they act off-center, causing both stages to twist along their path, and the new centers of mass of these individual stages serve as the pivot point around which the stages should rotate. Note that the upper stage is much heavier than the booster, so the prograde nudge it gets is tiny and doesn't cause as much of a turn compared to the booster, which tips into a shallow ballistic fall. Thereafter, spin correction methods are applied and the boosters also rely on their grid fins for flight control. SpaceX's Falcon 9 rockets, however, do not require spin correction, as they utilize an all-pneumatic system that separates stages without creating unwanted rotation after the main engine cuts off. Post-separation, the booster undergoes a controlled flip maneuver to return to Earth for vertical landing and reuse. Now, at separation, there are two recovery options for the first stage of the rocket, either return to launch site, also called RTLS, or land downrange on a drone ship, in short, DRL. Downrange recovery keeps more of that horizontal velocity, delays re-entry, and targets a drone ship placed under the ground track, and this saves propellant and preserves payload performance. RTLS, on the other hand, requires a boostback burn that counters much of the horizontal velocity picked up during ascent, and this costs additional change in velocity, brings back the stage earlier, and ends with a landing at the pad. For SpaceX, the choice between RTLS and downrange is set by payload mass and target orbit, the recovery propellant margin, and operations, which includes the availability and placement of an autonomous spaceport drone ship, sea state and winds along the return corridor, and approved sonic boom windows at the landing zones. Truly amazing to think of how far we've come in terms of space tech in the last several years, isn't it? Now, we're finally ready to introduce the concept of variable mass as we take a look at Boostback. During a burn, or for that matter, at any time the engines are lit, the rocket is not a fixed mass, although we have been treating it like so in order to simplify things. As the propellant leaves the vehicle, its mass decreases over time, and the thrust, we have familiarized ourselves with by now, comes from the expulsion of this mass out of the engine at exhaust speed. So a good first model is thrust approximately equals m prime times ve, where m prime is negative. So for the same throttle, the same thrust acts on a smaller and smaller mass, and the upward acceleration grows across the burn. After separation, the booster carries a downrange velocity, and to bring the stage back home, we have to change that velocity. Now this is where Boostback comes in. Boostback is an aimed impulse due to a brief powerful engine firing by the returning first stage after separation. This reverses the stage's flight along a controlled, almost parabolic trajectory to the designated landing zone, and it is the first of several burns that lead the booster to a safe landing. Fuel, of course, is the propellant for maneuver as we discussed, and it allows production of necessary thrust for this burn, and the controlled application of fuel allows for precise adjustments to the rocket's path and velocity, which changes with the logarithm of the ratio of the stage's mass at the start of the burn to its mass at the end. So each extra kilogram of propellant buys a little less change in speed than the previous one, and the Boostback is planned to cancel enough horizontal speed while keeping reserves for entry and landing. So it's finally time for our booster stage to return back to the launch pad with the right speed and the right timing. Two practical approaches include a hover-style landing and a Hoverslam, also known as the suicide burn, something you may be familiar with if you've played Kerbal Space Program. In a hover-style landing, the engine relights higher, part of the downward speed is cancelled early, thrust then holds the vehicle above the pad, and the stage settles gently in. This is simple to reason about, but it spends more propellant. In a hover slam, the stage coasts longer under gravity, the engine relights once later and much lower down, and the single burn is shaped so that the speed falls to zero exactly at touchdown. The trade is clear. Start too high and you waste fuel holding yourself up, start too low, and the available upward acceleration is not enough to stop in time. The question that arises then, how can the stage fall most of the way and still touch down at V equals zero? And at what altitude should the engine start? These are the exact questions that we are going to try and answer now. Let's think of the instant when the landing burn starts. Suppose the rocket is at a height h above the ground, and that it is moving downwards with a speed v. So for simplicity, we are considering a constant downward acceleration as well as constant mass. We can of course solve for the case where acceleration is changing over time, so we need a bit of calculus over there. So if you've watched my previous videos or if you're familiar with the concept of integration, then you would know that the height that the rocket or the booster stage has to cover is given by the area under the curve of v versus t, which is the integration of v dt. As for the acceleration, you can find that from the slope of v, and that is dv over dt. Now, since we consider the acceleration to be constant, we get a straight line drop from the initial velocity to zero, and that makes a triangle. And the area of this triangle would give us the stopping height, which is V0 squared over 2a. And of course, the rules of kinematics also gives us the same result, which you can cross-check over here. And that would also give us the time for stopping, which is V0 over the upward acceleration. Now, time for a quick sanity check through the work energy theorem. So, at ignition, the stage carries kinetic energy which is set by the initial velocity. And during the landing burn, the engine does upward work against the motion, while gravity does downward work along the motion. So, the engine's work undoes the speed while gravity gives back some of the speed. If you balance those two with the change in kinetic energy, you can obtain the same result for the stopping height as the one we got just before. Note though, for this segment, we are once again resorting to treating m as roughly constant and ignoring fuel loss to keep things clean, easy and intuitive. We can of course revisit the variable mass version of Hoverslam in a future video. Now let's check out some of the edge cases. If thrust equals mg, you can hover but you can't reduce the speed to zero any faster. Now if thrust is less than mg, the net acceleration is downwards and you can't stop before crashing into the pad. And if thrust T is greater than mg, the net acceleration is upwards, thus giving a finite stopping height and a short stopping time. Which finally brings us to the concept of throttle, something that we'd want to have comment over. Near touchdown, the quantity that matters is the net upward acceleration, A up, which is T over M minus G. To slow things down, we would need A up to be positive, so T over M must exceed G. There's also another thing, ignition delay, we can call it tau D. Now, once we start the landing burn, thrust comes into play a short time later, and in that interval, the vehicle falls roughly V0 times tau D. That loss simply shifts the required start height upward by that amount. Putting these together, we get an ignition window. The lower bound or H min comes from braking with the largest upward acceleration available, while the upper bound H max is when we have the least acceleration that still keeps thrust above mg. To that, add the shift due to ignition delay and a small margin. Lighting up the engines too early would cause us to hover and waste propellant. Light too late, and you run out of height before your speed decreases and you must brace yourself for a crash. The sweet spot is inside the window, and the constant acceleration that we have considered allows the rocket to touch down with zero velocity at the pad. With that, we have broken down some of the most important moments during flight of a rocket with just some light classical mechanics. If you like this video, don't forget to subscribe to my channel and share this, as it would help me keep creating more videos for you. And do comment if you'd like more of this, maybe a more in-depth look at some of the things we skimmed over today. So I'll see you soon again in the next video, and in the meantime, feel free to check out my other works. There may be something you'd like. Bye.